Good morning, church. Is everybody adjusting to the time change? Oh, good, because I haven't yet. So if my singing's off, that's why. A privilege to be together this morning. Would you all stand and join us as we worship together?
Give thyself. henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone.
Church family.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure to see you today. We are here to worship the Lord and thank Him for all that He's done for us. We have a few announcements today. We have a pizza party next week as Mike and Laura are leaving us, and we want to celebrate their time with us and our love for them. So please come to the pizza party. It's going to be a combination prayer time and pizza party following the service next week. Second announcement is we have prayer today in the fellowship hall following this service. Please join us as we continue to pray for our next chapter. We appreciate your prayers. Today's scripture is from Psalm 119. Actually, let me begin with prayer. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you're with us. We thank you that you move us. We thank you that you care for us and love us. And we seek you, Lord. This is your time. We seek you. Make our lives the way you want them to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 119, verse 9 through 6, reads, and I'm reading the NIV, "How can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, O Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word." May this be true. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand again.
Beauty that made this heart adore.
So many things come to mind. I thank you for the rain that fell yesterday and this beginning of spring today. And Lord, just the reminders even in that of the passing of time and the changes. And Lord, I think of little Ember coming into the world this week. And yet in the same breath, I pray for Georgine as she looks to the end of hers. And what a beautiful servant and sister she's been. And Lord, we just remember so many things, and we sing the songs we've been singing of the cross and of walking with you and of having a desire to listen to what you say to us. And I pray that's true for us, Lord, as we come to your word today, that we want you to speak because your servants are listening. Lord, may that be true, and may our time of worshiping you be just absolutely sincere and genuine as we continue. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You could be seated. Well, good morning. Last week, Laura and I attended the Conservative Baptist Annual Conference, and it was great to visit with old friends and colleagues. Great big convention center full of other pastors. And as I get ready to retire from the pastorate, I was looking through some old files and things and some old notes, and I came across one that I'd written down, and apparently I wrote it down just because I thought it was funny, and I just wanted to remember it and not forget it. But if it would be more funny probably if you knew me growing up. I was not a good kid. I was a very rebellious troublemaker kid, in trouble often. But the memory was a question that my daughter Shalomi asked my dad. And she was 3 years old when she asked it. And pretty much word for word, I have it written down. And she said, "Grandpa, were you surprised when Daddy turned into a pastor?" I love that. I mean, it was like just her asking, Daddy, were you surprised when Daddy turned into a pastor? Or Grandpa, were you surprised when Daddy turned into that pastor? I think of that because God has plans for our life that you and I would never have been able to chart out. But there are things we can understand about God's plans, and that has to do with his desires for how we live, how we walk with him. And that's going to be our topic this morning, is walking after God. But before we land in Ezra, we'll be in Ezra, but turn to the end of 2 Chronicles chapter 34, right before we walk into Ezra, right before the book of Ezra. I want to thank Ken back there for teaching last Sunday. I've heard a lot of positive things about it, and then I got to listen to it. Tim found an audio recording of it. The video recording didn't work, but the audio recording is online now. But from 2 Chronicles, Ken talked about the life of King Josiah, and he talked a lot about renewal and those things that went with his message. But as you're looking at chapter 34, the book of the law, scripture, all of scripture at that point, had been buried away for generations, but it was discovered after Josiah had been king already 18 years. So it had been buried away for generations, and they're doing some restoration work on the temple, and they came across this book. What's this book? And then they spent time reading it. And the workers, it says the workers found it. They gave it to Hilkiah the priest, who then gave it to Shaphan, the royal secretary, who then took it to show King Josiah, and then he read some of it to the king. And when Josiah heard from it, you guys know the rest of the story. Ken did a great job walking through this. I mean, he tears his robe. He responds in fear, in reverence, in worship, and a desire to obey and follow what they had just read. So King Josiah at that point, then he calls all the elders of Judah to the temple of Jerusalem, where then Josiah reads all the words, it says all the words of this book to the people. He reads the first five books of scripture. And then when he's finished, you get down to verse 31, there in 2 Chronicles 34, and it says that he made a covenant, and this is right from it, quote, before God, to walk after the Lord and to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart and all his soul, to perform the words of the covenant that were written in this book. And then verse 32 says that Josiah asked everyone present to join in making the same covenant to God. And then the next verse, verse 33, says that Josiah did not turn away from following the Lord all the days of his life. So before we talk about Ezra and Ezra's decision to walk after God, I just want to make sure that all of us understand what was presented to us last week. And now we're looking at this opportunity for us to make a covenant before God, to walk after him, to walk after the Lord, to keep his commandments, and to do these things with all our heart. I just want you to just let that sink in a little bit this morning. I'm going to read it again. A covenant before the Lord, to walk after the Lord, and to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all our heart and all our soul, to perform the words of the covenant that are written in this book. Now, like I said earlier already, I want this to be on our minds as we look at the book of Ezra, and we're going to really primarily focus on what the first part of that covenant is talking about, walking after God. Maybe it would even be best to try and picture what a person would be doing or how they would act if they were truly walking after God. Let me start by using some numbers that I found, numbers from various surveys through the years, and I've written down some of these I want to share with you. Gallup has been polling Americans for several years regarding their faith in God. In 1997, the number was 95% of Americans who professed faith in God. In 2011, it was 92%. In 2018, it was 87%. I mean, those declining numbers should alarm us, and I would love to spend more time discussing just that. But I want to focus on the number who profess faith in God to illustrate a different point. As I look around America, I hear and I hear numbers like 95 or 92 or even 87% who profess faith in God. I have a problem, a conundrum. There are suddenly Bible verses that I don't even know how to accurately interpret. And Laura had a conversation not long ago with a high school teacher she was doing some projects with, and this man was under the impression that the process of salvation had changed over the years. It was too limiting nowadays to assume Jesus Christ could still be the only way to heaven. And the statement that was brought up was one that Jesus made in Matthew 7, verse 13 and 14. He said, "Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction, and there are many who enter through it. For the gate is small and the way is narrow that leads to life, and there are few who find it." I recognize there are problems with using America as the primary criterion, but let me illustrate it this way. If nearly every American, I mean 9 out of 10, say that they are on that ladder, that narrow road leading to God, then I don't know about you, but that road does not sound narrow. That road does not sound hard to find. That road does not sound like there are few on it. I mean, if 90% of the people have a belief in God that they think would save them, which would be wonderful, but then I have a problem because something doesn't match up. Something externally is not adding up. And I would even be as bold as to say 50%, 40%, 30%. I mean, some other number. If that many in America are saying that, something still doesn't add up. A verbal response to a survey is obviously not saying everything. I mean, 90% say, "I'm on that road. I'm on that road." But it's really clear that there's more involved to getting on that road than making a self-proclamation that you're on that road. Let me hit pause for just a second, because this could be you. I mean, you may be thinking that, man, I'm on that road. Maybe you feel that way because you grew up in church. Maybe you feel that way because you are a good person who does good things. You're not near as bad as the rest of the people. You know, maybe you feel that way because you were raised in a Christian home and you identify with them. If any of those scenarios are why you feel like you are destined for heaven, I need to be really clear right now and tell you that none of those roads, none of those will get you to heaven. None of those will set you on the narrow road. John 14 tells us that the only way to heaven is a very narrow road. Yeah, exclusively narrow, if you want to use that word. Where Jesus Christ is the only way, the only truth, the only life. John 3 informs us that if that's the destination we desire, then we have to believe, we have to trust, we have to fully immerse ourselves in that truth. Colossians 1 reminds us that it's the cross where Jesus shed his blood for us. That is what saves us. And if you think you're saved any other way, then guess what? Jesus Christ died for nothing. If you want eternal life, then you have to recognize, you have to personally embrace those things. But let me tell you something else. It doesn't stop there. And this is where we're coming into Ezra now. Jesus said, if you desire me, then I want you to follow me. You know, if you want to be identified with me, then you have to walk with me. We've been singing some powerful songs that have been reminding us of that and what that looks like. The fruit of your life, the actions of your life are going to demonstrate your commitment to him. It doesn't save you, I know that. But it's going to prove that you are one of God's children. Do you covenant, let's go back to that word again, do you covenant to walk after God? How is it evident in your life? And I'm going to be talking more about that, but I want you just to be thinking of that right now. I mean, would someone guess that your whatever your struggle is, that your critical, gossipy, worldly, unforgiving, entitled self is a real follower of Christ? No, they probably won't guess that. So what should it look like? Incidentally, too, Laura was able to share the gospel with that teacher who and sought out more answers. But it's exciting to make use of the opportunities that God gives us to serve him and to honor him. So we can assume that if we walk after God, that means that our lives will be noticeably different than others. Obviously, noticeably different than we were prior to coming to Christ. You know, if you're a Christian, that means your life is in the process of being transformed. You are being radically changed. Radically changed. And you became a new creation at salvation. But according to Paul in Philippians 3, you are still being transformed. We are all still being changed. A lot of statements in Scripture, statements by Jesus, by Paul, by James, by even some of the psalmists, I mean, that remind us that something different externally needs to be visual, needs to be showing when you come to Christ. A fruit that matches the confession, a walk that matches the talk. And I'm going to continue with a few more numbers. I thought these were kind of intriguing. George Barn, a professional statistician, he said this. He said, there needs to be a gap. This is after a lot of surveys and some results of things he studied, but I just think this was intriguing. He said, there needs to be a gap of at least 40% points between the habits of Christians and non-Christians before he called it a transforming difference. Quote-unquote, transforming difference exists between the two. So, for example, part of the survey, 12% of Christians and 17% of non-Christians think it's better to get even than to get mad. What's the difference? 5%. He's saying until there's about a 40% difference, nobody's going to notice any difference whatsoever. Like some of the others. Here's another one. 29% of Christians regularly watch an R-rated or higher movie every week compared to 39% of the non-Christians. That's a little better. That's up to 10%. But it's still not that massive difference to show some transforming difference. And surveys and stats, I mean, as we all know, it could be wrong, it could be biased, whatever, and maybe even sound a little bit legalistic like this, but I am only introducing this to get us to think about our lives, to reflect on our life. What does it look like? Do people know? I mean, absolutely know, without a doubt, that you are a real follower of Christ. One that definitely is walking after God. Or do they think you're just like them? You know, I think honestly a lot of us, and I've struggled with this for years. I mean, we all want to be identified as just part of that group. Some of the things we choose to do. Paul talks about in Galatians 1:10 that we do to get the acceptance, the approval of man. I do it to look cool with the people around me. These things I'm involved in, I'm doing, I want to do because if I didn't do them, then I'd look different. You know, we understand too that God wants us to come as we are. When we come to him, when we first come to him, we're not waiting to get our lives perfect. He doesn't ask that. He doesn't expect that. But I think also in the same breath, when we do come, all of us perfectly understand we will never get our lives perfect this side of glory. We will always struggle. And I'll get back to that in a little bit. So let's look at Ezra. Ezra, a little bit of historical background when you're coming into Ezra. Israel, the north part of the divided kingdom, has already been conquered. And then Judah is what's left, the southern division, left a little bit later. They're taken captive by Persia's Babylonian king, Nebuchadnezzar, in 605 B.C. And we can read about this in the book of the Kings, the book of the Chronicles. We walk through all that history. We can actually read about it in real secular books of history. We can see it in recent archaeological finds and things going on. But the war continued. It virtually went on, mostly due to rebellion, until Jerusalem was destroyed in 586 B.C. And a couple years earlier than that, about 597 B.C., Nebuchadnezzar took about 10,000 Hebrews captive with him back to Babylon. Part of that group was Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. We read about that in the book of Daniel. And the Hebrews were in captivity until about 536 B.C. So Jeremiah has prophesied already. He's prophesied earlier. Babylon's going to be in power for about 70 years. Isaiah prophesies that to get them out, there's going to be this leader, and he even names him Cyrus. Cyrus is going to be the one who releases the captives and all that. And I love the prophecies of Scripture. But the book of Ezra was written after the Hebrews' captivity is over. It's the first of three post-exilic books. So the ones after that, all the same time period, essentially. But the Hebrews were allowed to go back to their homeland. Not all of them went, but allowed to go back to their homeland after the exile's over. They're allowed to go back. Specifically, when you're reading Ezra, it's talking about rebuilding the temple. Little more than the first half of Ezra, chapter 1 through 6, is dealing with this first group of Hebrews who went back to Jerusalem under the reign of, or under the kind of leadership of Zerubbabel, which was during the reign of Cyrus and Darius, and they're allowed to go back. And then the second half comes in from chapter 7 on, and they're allowed to go back, and that's during the reign of the Persian king Artaxerxes under Ezra. Ezra's leading this group back. And Ezra is a Hebrew. Ezra is a priest. He's a scribe, which means he's a teacher of the law. He's studying this. He is a man totally devoted to God. And Ezra, some of the things you read about in this book is this struggle Ezra has to keep the Israelites walking right. The Israelites are marrying people from other tribes, which should have been eliminated many, many years earlier. But these people from these other tribes are leading them to other gods and other religions. And so it's just a struggle all the way. But Ezra is trying to get the people to understand we have to walk with God. We have to walk after God. Let's work on that. And so you come to chapter 7. Look at chapter 7. So again, between chapter 6 and chapter 7, there's this gap of almost 60 years between the group that went with Zerubbabel and the group now going with Ezra. And it starts off just describing Ezra in chapter 7. After this, in the reign of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, Ezra, the son of Sariah, son of Azariah, son of Hilkiah, son of Shalom, and it continues down until you start getting a little more specific. Verse 5, son of Abishua, son of Phinehas, son of Eleazar, son of Aaron, the chief priest, Aaron, the brother of Moses. This Ezra, the one whose great, 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 great uncle was Moses, the giver of the law, essentially. This is the man who went up from Babylonia. He was a scribe skilled in the law of Moses, that the Lord, Jehovah, the God of Israel, had given, and the king granted him all that he asked, for the hand of the Lord his God was on him. And there went up also to Jerusalem in the seventh year of Artaxerxes the king, some of the people of Israel, some of the priests, some of the Levites, all of these others, gatekeepers, temple servants. And Ezra came to Jerusalem in the fifth month, which was in the seventh year of the king. For on the first day of the first month, he began to go up from Babylonia, and on the first day of the fifth month, he came to Jerusalem, for the good hand of his God was on him. And verse 10, for Ezra had set his heart to study the law of the Lord, and to do it, and to teach his statutes and rules in Israel. So King Artaxerxes gave Ezra, this priest and teacher of the law, the authority to go back to the land of Judah, establish the law of Moses there, and do whatever you need to, even in building some polity and some government around you, to do what you have to accomplish this task. But look again at verse 10. This verse just stands out. For Ezra had set his heart to study the law of the Lord and to do it and to teach his statutes and rules in Israel. So Ezra devoted himself to these things in regard to the law of God. Now this is where we could reflect back on King Josiah that I started with. That covenant that Josiah made, very, very similar. So many similarities. And I love reading things like this, where you read of godly men and women in Scripture who decided to, I am absolutely going to stand firm in my walk. I'm going to commit to follow after you, God, with all my heart. Everything. Not just part of it, not just some of it, but every bit of it. And I love that. One of the very first commentary sets I bought in my pastoral study was the old Matthew Henry set. Matthew Henry was a pastor in England about 300 years ago, and I was walking through his study again, and his exposition of Ezra, I absolutely loved this section right here, his notes on it. So I kind of copied those, and that's what you're going to walk through with me this morning, these five traits that we can read of in the life of Ezra regarding his attention to the law and what it says just in verse 10. So number one is this. He chose to study the law of the Lord. He chose to study the law of the Lord. I mean, the Chaldeans of the area where he was, where he'd been exiled, all those things, where Ezra grew up, they were very ambitious students of astrologers, of magicians' writings, of all those things. And, you know, Ezra could have been tempted to follow after some of those things, but Ezra chose not to. He knew it was what it was that God desired of him. He knew what it was that God desired he study. And he did just that. And you think of, even think of Joshua, okay? Joshua's taking over from Moses. And when Joshua comes on the scene to take over, God encourages Joshua so many times. God encourages Joshua. He says, Joshua, you need to be strong. You need to be courageous. Hang in there. I will be with you. I promise. Just hang in there. But there's a very specific verse right at the beginning of Joshua where he says, I want you to do this. I'm going to take care of you, but I want you to meditate on my law day and night. I want it to be a part of your life. I want you to be careful to do everything that's written in it, and then you will be prosperous and successful. And that's how he ended the statement. There is an enormous value in knowing the law of the Lord. Matter of fact, look again with me back, keep your place there in Ezra, but go back to Psalm 119 that Ed just read a little bit ago. I want to read this again. This is a great passage. Thank you, Ed, for reading this, because verse 9 through 16 is describing that same thing. There is a value in knowing the Word of God. How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. So many benefits. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I declare all the rules of your mouth. In the way of your testimonies, I delight as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. So secondly, he sought the law of the Lord. I mean, he chose to study it, but then second, he sought the law of the Lord. And this is just going one step further. It was more than just choosing to study this specific thing. It's more than just that. Ezra also searched, he examined, he researched, he studied the scriptures. I'm going to spend time in this. I'm going to look to see what it is that God wants from my life. I'm going to study the character of God. So many things that we cannot discover without study. We have to spend time studying. And the author of Psalm 119, there's another verse toward the end. Psalm, what is it? Verse 155 goes with this pretty well. It says, "Salvation is far from the wicked, for they do not seek your statutes." Salvation is far from the wicked. They do not seek your statutes. You understand what he's saying? He's saying, you have to look, you have to dig. Third, number three, he made a conscious effort to do the law of the Lord. Go back to King Josiah. He made a conscious effort, a decision to do what the word said. They had just read the word to him, and Josiah responds by just dropping on his face, tearing his robe, making sure everybody else hears the word, making sure everybody else covenants before the Lord. He says, this is important. We are going to do this. And then Ezra, after Ezra studied God's word, he then applied God's word. And it became Ezra's practice and desire to follow God's will, to follow God's law, is what he says, the word. The way he acted became based upon God's desires. The things he said became based upon God's desires. The choices he made were based upon God's desires. This progression is taking place in that it's not enough just to know God's desires. We have to do them. You need to serve in addition to study. But all of us, I think we're familiar with the statement Joshua made at the end of his book, you know, where he has made a decision. As for me and my house, we will what? We will serve the Lord. We're not just going to know it. We're going to do it. We're going to follow it with all our heart. Number four, he taught Israel the statutes and judgments of the law of the Lord. So what Ezra knew and studied, he used to benefit others. So after he sought, then he taught. After he practiced, then he preached. I mean, he saw the benefits of knowing and desired that others know as well. You know, part of what we're doing right here, right now, you guys are part of a fellowship, obviously, but we are fellowshipping. And not just this hour, but prayerfully all week long, we take opportunities to fellowship together. And we fellowship because we are encouraging one another and we are learning from one another. We are growing together. We are comforting one another. We're building one another up. We share our testimonies with one another to express, hey, here's what I've experienced. Here's what I've been learning. This is what I've been doing. You know, Bible study groups, that the teacher is sharing what they've experienced. Even at work, your secular workplace, you are talking with other people about what you have experienced when you share, when you witness to someone. Here's what I've learned. Here's what I've experienced. And I want to teach you. Back in Ezra 7, if you go down a little bit further, go to verse 25, Artaxerxes the king is instructing Ezra, I want you to do this with your magistrates and your judges and all these people and everything. Gets down toward the end of that verse. All such as know, everyone who knows the laws of your God, and those who do not know them, you shall teach. Whoever doesn't know it, you have the opportunity to teach them. And here's a secular king saying this to Ezra. You know, Scripture tells us so many, many times how we benefit from being taught. And in turn, we should teach others. We should teach others what we learn. The fellowship provides us with opportunities. Proverbs describes it, you know, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. We are growing together. It's a beautiful thing. But it's not enough just to know it. can't tell you how many people I know, and I know you're the same. You know these people who just, they know it. I could think of one man I know really well, former Bible professor. He reads God's word all the time. I mean, he looks at the original language. He does better at original languages than I do. He's reading it in Greek. He's reading it in Hebrew. All of these things. He has the all the traits of number one that I just gave you, number two, and number four. But number three is missing in his life. He knows it. He studies it. He doesn't apply any of it. You know, you've heard me stress this enough times. You know it's a big concern to me that every one of us need to apply what we learn from God's word. I need to practice God's word. God's word needs to be producing something in our life. Is it producing something? Is it having a practical effect in our life? I mean, what difference does any of it make? What difference does God's truth make to you? It's important we study it. It's important we memorize it. But honest to goodness, I could care less if you could stand there and quote half the Bible to me in Hebrew. I couldn't care less if you did not live it. If you don't have the desire to do what God desires and live it out in an evident way, then something is drastically wrong and missing in your life. So how are we doing at teaching others? And I'm talking everybody. I mean family, peers around us, casual acquaintances, whatever. What do you spend your time talking about? What comes out of your mouth? Ephesians 4:29, great verse, let no unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is useful for building one another up so that the grace of God may be evident to all. Wow. Last point, number five. Says Ezra did these things with his whole heart. Again, this is like Josiah's covenant. But Ezra, it says, he devoted his heart. He prepared his heart. He set his heart to know God's desires and to do God's desires and to teach God's desires. He persevered. This is a great passage back in Deuteronomy chapter 10. So here's back in the law, and this is an instruction Ezra obviously took to heart. Ezra read this. Knew it. Deuteronomy 10, verse 10 and 12 both. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep the commandments and statutes of the Lord which I am commanding you today for your good. Another one of those covenants, really. Okay, church, think about this for a little bit. I mean, what difference does any of this make? What difference does it make to me? What difference does it make to you? I mean, every week we could have fun studying these stories of Elijah and Josiah and Ezra, and we go home and say, that was a fun story, I like that. And then Monday, we're all the same person again that we were, sadly, Saturday night. None of us want to be guilty of that. And I posed a question a couple weeks ago, and I am thinking of it again right now. I mean, if the Bible were still being written today, what would God write about you? I mean, if you were going to be included, what would God write about you? I mean, it'd be great if it was a story like Ezra. Our time on earth, I suppose it could seem long some days, especially when we're having problems at home, at the job, with family, physical health, whatever. But I mean, in reality, really, it is just a drop in the bucket compared to eternity. What are we going to do with our few years here? Will we live to please ourselves, or will we live to please God? Will we do things to be accepted by or to look cool to other people, like I said Galatians 1:10 talks about? Will we live like the rest of the world, or will we live drastically different? You know, will we focus on success, or will we focus on God's standard of faithfulness? Will we, like Ezra, devote ourselves to the observance and the obedience of the word, of the law of God? And will we teach its decrees and laws in our circle of influence? I mean, that would be fantastic. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you humbly, asking that you would continue to shape us, help us. You know our desires. You know the desires of our heart. We want these things. We want to follow after you with all our heart. And yet so often we struggle with these little distractions that have us chasing after those things that find the approval of man, or these things that make us feel better when we can critique and gossip about other people, or whatever it might be, Lord, all these distractions, and we need your help. Lord, help us live for you, because it is all about you. We love you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand, everyone.
It's all about you. your glory and your fame. It's not about me. As if you should do things my way, for you alone are God and I surrender to your ways. For you alone are God and I surrender to your ways.
Father, we thank you for this day, for this time with you and together with each other. Help us take the word of the Lord today as we go and live it out in our lives. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Enjoy the Lord today, everyone.